Yesterday we had discussed about dining philosopher's problem, the three different cases which was associated with the dining philosopher's problem. Then apart from that, we saw like how to solve those issues, okay, using semaphore. So we had seen that, okay. Then moving to the next issue, we had basically a new set of problem called the bounded buffer problem or the producer-consumer problem. So I think you must be remembering what is it. We had spoken very briefly, actually an overview. So today we are going to see what is producer-consumer problem. Okay, what are the challenges that may be there if suppose the processes are not synchronized in a producer-consumer problem, how we are going to tackle using a semaphore. So all those things we are going to see it. Okay. So I think everyone are having the video, like the screen is available and also the voice. So you can type if it is not available. Okay. So I hope that for everyone, there is no problem. I think Nihal is typing something. Nihal, you are not getting the voice or the screen. Okay, I'll just restream this one. Is it visible now? Is it visible now? Okay, so let us proceed then. So this was the quote that we had seen yesterday briefly. What will it do? So basically here we are having two processes which are cooperating in nature. That means one process will affect the execution to another process. Okay, and they will be sharing certain common things. So count was a global variable which was shared by both the process. And a common buffer was there for both the process for maintaining the item, which was produced by the process and which would be consumed by the consumer process. Okay. So in this code, we had seen yesterday, like for example, if a situation was there, like for example, if producer and consumer are synchronized, that is, one is coming after the previous one has completed its task. Okay. So they are synchronized. So if we look here in the code, what are the things we were having? We were having a global variable. Let us see from the producer side, we were having a variable item P, which would keep the item produced, okay, in it as a content. Then we had a loop. So this loop would be iterating, let's say, for situations where the producer is generating or producing three items, more than one item. So for that, I should not write, let's say for five items, I should not write the same five times same code, isn't it? For generating, you can say five items. So for that, what we have to do, we have to use a loop. So same thing here, I have used a while loop. Okay, taking this, that this condition is true. Now here, what are the things I have used? Let's say N I have taken. What is N? N is the size of that buffer memory. Okay, that means the total size of the buffer. Okay, so this loop will be continuing, okay, till this condition inside the while loop is true. Now, this statement, when I executed, what did I get? I got that whatever the item has been produced, it will be stored in the buffer. So how will it be stored? For that, I have, you can say the index, okay? That will be taken care by in. So what is in? In is basically a variable, a local variable, because it will be accessible only within this function. So it's a local variable. Consumer will not have in. Only this producer will be knowing about in. So in will basically be a local variable which will keep track of two things. One thing is that it will keep track of the location of the buffer array. And second thing, the second line will basically of this one where we are using in, the second line of the code will basically give me the value where the next item should be inserted. Okay, so these are the two things. Again, I'm saying in will solve two purpose. In is a local variable. First purpose, it will be able to do this part of the code. So basically, it will give the location of the buffer array. Like for example, in this diagram, if you see buffer, okay, this array name is buffer. If I say buffer zero, so in this location, in the zeroth location, it should be able to store the you can say element. So buffer is int's value will be zero. So item is, let's say, x1. So x1 will be stored in buffer, okay, zero, like the first location of the array. The next time when I execute, so already x1, suppose it's stored here. Okay, so next item, if it has to be produced and stored in the buffer, so where it has to be produced? In the next location, so here. So that means I have to increment the value of in. Why I have to increment the value of in? So that next time when, let's say, another element has to be inputted into the buffer, then it will know, okay, so in value got updated once. So next time in value will be 1. So let's say item is x2. So x2 will be stored with buffer of 1. So buffer of 1 means what? x2 will be stored here. So in that way it will be going. Okay. Then count, we said that count is a global variable. That means a variable which will be accessed by both the producer function as well as the consumer function. Now count, count will just keep track of what, how many items got inserted or how many items got removed. Okay, so if items are being inserted into the array, then count value has to be incremented. If items are removed from the array, from the buffer, then count value has to be reduced or decremented by 1 unit, because it's an array, so 1 unit only we are increasing or decreasing. So that's why the +1 and -1 is there. Now, whenever we are executing this kind of instruction, let's say just one piece of line of code, count is assigned to count +1. In a high level language like C, C++ or Java, we can get this addition done just in one step. But if this step has to be represented in micro instruction level, then how will it be do? Will we be able to execute it one step? No, we will not be able. So in micro instruction, as you have already learned in computer organization, and also in system software lab, we already know that how we can do this. We can do this in this way. First of all, we have to load the register and the count variable, and whatever the count is having, the content. Initially, count is how much? Initially, count is zero. We have already declared here. Initially, count is how loaded in the register, RP. RP is the general register. So any register I can take, naming I can give as per my choice. So I have given RP. Okay, it's up to you, whatever name you want to give. So zero has been loaded inside RP. Now count should be incremented. So how will I do? I've used this logic. I increment the value of the content which is there inside the register. So what value I'm having inside RP? I already know that count value has been stored inside RP. That is zero. So this will be incremented by 1 unit. So zero will become 1. Then in the next step, what I'm doing, whatever RP's value, what is RP's value? 1. So it will be put in where? In the count variable. So count now will become how much? 1. So initially count was 0. We stored that value in a register. We incremented the value in that register, and then that incremented value of the register is stored in the count variable. Okay, so this is how basically the function is working in the producer section. Now, once this part of the code is executed, then what happens is the process terminates, and then another process comes into the system. That means the CPU will execute another process. So what process we are having? The consumer. So from the name itself, it means that consumer process, basically what will it do? Whatever item we are having in the buffer memory, that item will be consumed by the consumer process, okay? So the logic is similar only. What we will do here is, first of all, we will check whether the count is not equal to zero. Because if the count is zero, that means no items are there inside the buffer, okay? So that condition, if that condition is there, then the loop will not run. So if the count is not equal to zero, then we will be able to execute. So what we will do, we will, whatever the buffer item is there. So how will we get the buffer item? Again, we have used a local variable. Like we have used in here, a local variable to keep track of the next location that the element has to be inserted. Out will basically be a local variable which will keep track of the location that was removed. Suppose if an item is removed from the buffer. So what I have to do? I have to, decrement, isn't it? The pointing position from there to the predecessor's level, like to the previous step. So same thing here also. So first of all, I have to get the element from the buffer. So let's say if buffer 0 contains X1, okay? So how will this code be recognized? So buffer, so 0, buffer 0, okay, so item C. So item C, so X1 will be put here. Then let's say I have few more items. I have few more items, let's say this one. So next line, out was 0. So next line, I have incremented the value of out, okay? So what I have done is I have pointed out now. I've taken out to be how much? 1. I would have taken out value 1. From here, out was how much? 0. So 0 plus 1 is how much? 1. 1 modulo 8 is how much? 1. So out will be now a new value, which is 1. Okay. Now, after I have removed any item, so what should that mean? The count value should be decremented, because ultimately we are counting how many, fill up has taken place. So whenever addition is taking place, just remember of items, we're increasing the value of count. But whenever deletion is taking place, we are lessening the value of count. Okay. So similarly, like count is assigned to count plus 1. It took 3 steps for execution in the micro instruction level. So similarly, count is assigned to count minus 1 also will take 3 steps for execution in the micro instruction level. The only difference being that one is increasing. So that's why we are having. And in case of decrementing, we will proceed with DECR. That is the only thing. Now, this is very, very nice if the process are coordinating or are in synchronized way. That means one is coming after one has completed. So there is no problem. If suppose this has inserted 3 items at one go, okay, then the consumer, once this is done, then the consumer can come, take the CPU, and then can consume those 3 items. Okay. So if they are in a serial order, so there is no problem. But what is the problem if suppose they're not appearing in a serial order? So let us see that case. Okay. So let us see that case. So case 1, I've already explained. Okay. I've shown with code also, examples also I've shown, like how the code is working. Okay. Why I'm doing this? So that it makes easier. So consumer side also have spoken. Okay. Now let us see if the producers and consumers are not synchronized. Okay. So let's say producer is like there, then consumer may come. Then what will be in such scenario? Okay. So let us see. We have such situation. Let's say we have the buffer, same thing only. So what is the scale here? Buffer size is 8. Okay, so I have drawn one more extra. So let me delete this one. So it should be 0 to 7. So that means that the size of the buffer is 8. Why 8? Because we are starting from 0. Okay, so 0 up to 7 is 8. Okay, now let us consider this instance. Let's say at any point of time, let us say the producer produced 3 items. So from the code, that means that code of the producer part, was executed three times. So if three times execution happened, so three items produced, isn't it? Now, based on the above situation, what should be the value of count and in? Okay, so based on this situation, we know that in will basically give me the value of the next location that it should be pointing to. Because at the next location, if a new item comes, there I have to insert. Okay, so let's say I have inserted up till how many places? 1, 2, 3. Okay, so next level is what? 4. All right, so it will be 4. So that's why the in value is 4. Okay, in will basically start, we are taking that it starts from 1. Okay, so it's starting from 1. Count, on the other hand, it is starting from which value? Count, on the other hand, I already discussed that. Count initially only it's initialized to what? 0, isn't it? It's a global variable. So if it has inputted, let's say if suppose 3 items are inserted into the array, that means 3 items are produced, then what will be the value of count? So it started from 0, 1. 0, 1, 2, isn't it? And then there is an increment in the code. Count is assigned to count plus 1. Okay. So in this case, what is happening? Based on the above situation, in will basically point to the next location. In value is always 1 more than count. See, in value is always 1 more than count, as it shall give us the location of what next item is to be inserted. Okay. So it will start like this. 1, 2, 3, and then 4th. That means after, it's not the index, okay? In is not the index. You can say it is a kind of a series of steps that it starts from 1, 2, 3, and 4th. Count, however, it's the one unit less, okay? In value is always 1 more than count. Count is, however, always 1 unit less because its initialization is done from 0, okay? So let us say that, okay, so it's to be inserted. Okay, now in this case, let us take some instance. Let us say producer has produced one more item. So let's say X4 has been produced and that has been inserted. Clear? Now, from the consumer side, count, let's say, is equal to 0. Okay, let me... Okay, this part we did not write, this one. Okay, this is not required. It may create confusion. Okay, so let us say that a producer has produced one more item X4 and that has been inserted into the array. All right, so what will be count? Count was initially 3 before the item was inputted. So once the item was inputted, so what will be the count value? What will be the count to execute this section of the code? Count is assigned to count plus 1. So after the item is incremented, count value is incremented. That means count value is increased after the item is inserted. Now let's say before the execution of the highlighted code, that means count is assigned to count plus 1. In the micro instruction level, we already saw that it works like this. We have a register, we have the count variable, that count variable value is loaded into the register. Register's value, that means the content of the register is increased, and the increased value of register is again, you can say, stored in the count variable. Now, I'm saying that before the execution of this highlighted code, the yellow color one, let's say preemption takes place. That means the control is taken out now from the producer process. It executed all the lines of code, but just before it could execute the last part, what has happened? Preemption took place. That means context switching took place here. So the control from the producer process now goes to which process? Which is the other available process? It's the consumer process. Okay. Why the preemption takes place? It may be because of several reasons. Okay. So in book, they did not say these can be the reasons. Hardware, software, interrupts came up, or maybe consumer was a higher priority process. It requested the CPU that it wants to take the CPU for its execution. So many various reasons can be. Okay. So before it could execute, count was how much? 3. But after insertion, count's value should have been inserted. It should be now 4, isn't it? But before that increment could have happened, that means the storage could have happened. Who has come now? The other process has come. Okay, the preemption took place, context which has taken place. Now what will happen? The value of count could not be updated and execution of producer process will not be completed. So because of the context switching, item has been stored. There is no doubt. X4 is stored. But count value should have been increased the moment that item was put into the array. But that did not happen. Some interrupt took place and then the control went to the consumer process. Okay. Now, how will the CPU behave? So now CPU at this situation will look, if other process is available, then it will say, yes, it is available. A consumer process, which is of a higher priority. So that will be given the control. Now let us see what will happen on the consumer side. Okay. So as CPU shall take in the consumer process, it shall run. It shall run the consumer process code. Okay. So what was the consumer process code? If you remember, we have already written two sides, no, consumer and producer. So this was the consumer side. So this code will be running. So I will take a part of this code. Let's say, let me take this part. Okay. Let me take these 3 lines, okay, of the code, because other things are okay. Only in those 3 lines only the challenge comes, okay? So let us see what will happen in that case if the control goes there. So as the CPU shall take the consumer process, it shall run the code. So in the highlighted line, so I've already highlighted this part of the line of the code, out value is 0. So initially out also will be starting from 0. Now we should not get confused that in and out are local variables. So their scope and lifetime will be only till they are inside the function. I think you already know from programming that if suppose we have local variables, then the lifetime, visibility and scope of those variables lasts only inside that function. So once they are out, they have no relevance. So similarly, out also is a local variable. So that's why its initial value will be starting from, you can say some value, let's say 1 or 0, whatever it may be. Okay, so here they have saying that it is 0. So item C shall get value of buffer 0. What do you mean by item C? Item C is again a variable which will be getting the item which is in the common buffer. So buffer out. So buffer, what is the value of out initially? 0. So buffer 0. Buffer 0, what was there in buffer 0? Buffer 0, X1 was there, isn't it? X1 was there. So X1 will be stored inside item C. So after item C has been stored, then what I have to do? I have to increment the value of out because it has to point to the next location where there can be item. So what can be the next location? Buffer 1, that means out value should be how much? 1. Because buffer 1, buffer out, buffer out's value 1 will be pointing to the next item into the array. So we have to increment, okay? Then another thing we have to remember is that since count is a local variable, so whatever the value was there in the producer part, okay, that value will be common in the consumer also, because in global variable, I said, I think local, count is a global variable. In a global variable, basically, the value is, you can say, same throughout for any function, for any part of the program. Whenever you are accessing that value, it remains same. Okay. So what happens is, what was count value initially? What was count value initially before here? Count was 3. It should have been 4, but it didn't happen because there was a context switch, isn't it, at this point where the increment of count was supposed to take place. So count value is how much? How much is count value? 3 here. So similarly here also, it will get 3 only. Okay. So count is 3. So after this line, what I will do is, I will be increasing the value of out. One, the value of out is increased. Then I have to decrement the value of count. Why decrement? In case of producer, whenever producer is producing an item, whenever that item is kept in the buffer, count is increased. Okay. Whereas in case of consumer side, whenever we are taking the item or consuming the item from the buffer, we have to decrease the value of count. That it has to be very clear. Why? Because as you are taking the item, okay, that count will reflect basically, that minus will basically reflect that the deduction of items from the stock. That means this many items are taken off. So how we are basically representing the logic in the program? By decrementing the value of count. Whereas if suppose in real time situation also, suppose if any item I'm putting in the, so what I'm doing, I'm adding items, isn't it? So that's why in producer side, there is a count plus one. Okay. So similarly here also, when I'm consuming or taking out any item from the stock here is the buffer array. So I have to decrement. So initially count was how much? Three, because count is a global variable. If it is three there, here also it has to be three. So it will be three minus one. So what is three minus one? Two. So count will be getting the value two. Okay. So this is a function call they're doing. That's not so relevant. Now, how this line will be executed? Same way, same thing. Three lines of micro instructions, but the only difference is we are decrementing the value of count. Okay. So now, once this is done, so what will be the result? What will be the result? So let's see. Same thing they have said. Okay. So now, let's say consumer has done its work. Consumer code is done. Okay. Consumer code is done. Now, where will the control go back? To the producer side. So once it goes to the producer side, what will happen? So here, count has given how much? 3 minus 1, that is 2, isn't it? Count has given me the value hint has here to be 2. Okay. Count has given me the value here 2. Okay. Now, so once this code here is executed, the CPU is executed, so it will release the consumer. Okay. So now who will be executed? Producer will be executed, because producer could not finish this instruction. It could not instruction. So it will, the control will come here. Okay. Now the main part is this part only, that the actual, you can say, problem takes. Now before the producer was out from the CPU execution, again, I'm saying before the producer was out from the CPU, you can say execution, that last part of the code, okay, all its information was saved in the PCB. PCB, we know that is the process control block. Why do we save all the information that has the recent information of the processes? Why do we save? So that next time, if there is a context switching, we don't start everything all over again from the beginning. We basically start from that point where we had stopped. Okay. So there basically, whatever the value was count was in the producer side for that part of the code. Okay. Count is assigned to count plus one. So for that part of the code, before that, whatever work we have done, the process details and information will be stored in the process control block. So once the control is back to the producer, then after it executes, count is assigned to count plus one. So while it takes those information from process control block, then it will not see the value of count as two, which the consumer had produced, but it will see the value of count as three. Why three? Because all the information that the producer process had executed before that instruction, that last line of the instruction, okay, all those information, even the value of count that the producer had produced, that will be considered. Okay, so what will happen now? So in this situation, the instruction shall start from the point where the instruction has stopped, as all its information was saved in the PCB or in the process control block. So while it executes the third instruction, the register value will be how much? 4. Why 4? Let us go here. The register value will be 4. Why? Let us see. Because while the instruction was executed, count was how much? 3. 3 was stored in RP. Now, RP was increased to how much? 4, because we are incrementing by 1 unit, because it will be accessing, right, the register's value. So 3 plus 1 is how much? 4. So that 4 value will be now updated in the count. So what will we get? So after that, if that is the case, then what will happen? Then in the third instruction, we will basically be, where is the, so after the execution of third instruction, RP value is 4. So new value of count is how much? How much is the new value of count? 4. So new value of count is 4. Okay. Now let's say again, there is a context switch. Okay. So the producer completed its work. It's over. Now the CPU now gives the control to whom? Consumer process. Now in this situation, again, it shall resume its instruction from the point it had stopped, as all its information is safe in the process control block, isn't it? So in the third instruction, what was the value of RC? Where is the count? What was the value of count? Okay, the count is 2 here. As per the, you can say, the, what is it called? The consumer, isn't it? Is 2. But here, what are we getting in this case? We are getting 4. Very good. Okay, so in this case, in one section, count value is 4. And in the other section, count value is 2. So now in this situation, now producer presses, completes his work and CPU switches for consumer process. Now in this situation, again, it shall resume its instruction from the point it has stopped. Okay. In third instruction, RC value is 2. And so count shall get a new value 2. That means there are 2 items in the buffer where there are 3. Okay. So this actually leads to a race condition. So basically what is happening here is, let's say they are saying that in this situation we had decremented the value of RC. So while we have decremented the value of RC, okay, just wait 1 second then. Okay, so here RC was basically decrement. So count was okay, this is taken. So once this is taken, RC value is decremented. So RC was initially how much? 4. So now it will become 3. So before preemption takes place and consumer, all right. So after execution, RP value is this. So new value of count is 4. Okay, done. Now producer process completes its work and CPU switches for consumer process. Okay, so it will go back to consumer process. Now in this situation again, now, whose internet? Is it my internet giving issue?
No, sir. I think like everybody's internet is giving problem, not yours.
Okay. So my part is fine, right?
Yes, sir. Since I can like hear you access. And see you properly, that means like from your end it's fine, but from theirs it's
okay. Not. Okay. So they have to then look through the video later, no?
Yes, sir. Like, yeah, they can see the video later in YouTube if they want.
Ha. Okay. Okay, so same thing, like here the count value is 4 now. That control was given to the producer. Producer did not start everything all over again. The page of the register value was stored in the, that information was from PCB and count value. Okay, so all again, what has happened is there are two conflicting values now. Two conflicting values. So one part count is 4. One part count is 4, whereas in other case count is like 2. Okay, so this actually basically gives you incorrect values, because the final result is giving one value of count is 4 and the other value of count is 2. Okay, but where is 3 then? That means wherever we want to consume the third item, we will not be able to consume. So this kind of situation basically will lead us to a race condition, as incorrect values will be competing for the final result. So any query till now, producer consumer problem, can
sir,
type.
Sir, I had a question about the
yes.
Yes. producer code part, the code. Can you please open it up? So in the code, the while loop
producer.
Wait,
okay, let me go up. It's at the top. This is the producer.
Yes,
tell me.
So the producer part of the while loop is count equals to n, but that while loop won't run, right? I mean, count value is 0 and n is 8. So like, okay. Should the code be count is less than equals to n?
Exactly. You are right. So count should be.
Okay.
Because
yes,
it will be.
I was confused about that.
Okay. Fine. Because while making also, I did not check, but yes, it's sir. True. It has to be lesser than equal. If it's equal, then we are having one condition, right?
Yes,
so that is one of the things. Okay. Any other question?
No, sir.
Others, please point out. Main thing is basically the context switching only. That means, suppose if there is a preemption, like part, if the process preempts, okay, the last part, if it is not being able to execute. So while it goes to another process, if it's a common shared variable, that variable value will not be, you can say, consistent. Okay, so let's say if something is increment, like have to be inputted. So count value has to be increased. Let's say count value after incrementing, it is 4. After we have taken out, consumed. Okay, so count value has to be decremented. That means count value has to be 3, isn't it? It should be that way. But if suppose the process are not synchronized, okay, and they are switching from one end to another, then in that case, basically, the values will be inconsistent. Like, so for example, if I'm adding an item, count value is 4, that is fine. But if suppose there was context switching and I have gone to consumer, it has taken the item, count value is now 2. So will it be correct? No, right? It should have been 3. Then this will give a very, you can say, a kind of an ambiguity, you can say. Okay, so in this situation, basically how to tackle these kind of issues, we have to go for some methods or mechanisms which can overcome such kind of problems. Okay, so basically we will see how we are going to solve this one using binary semaphore. Okay, so why I'm taking binary semaphore? Because already we have talked about before what is a semaphore, how it solved issues related to, you can say, dining philosopher's problem as well. Okay, so we will go to the solution part. Okay, so let us go to the solution part. Okay, so this is a fresh, you can say, code again, okay, because semaphore concept will be coming here. So for those, again, who do not know what is the binary semaphore, so in brief, I want to say that basically through a binary semaphore or a semaphore, other process will be getting an indication that whether the response, okay, to be taken by a process. So here the resource actually is, you can say, the buffer, okay, which is being used by both the processes. Okay, so accordingly we will be able to know here. Okay, so here certain other things I have taken. So I have taken some variables like empty and full. Okay, n is same, a n is same as, you can say, the size of the buffer, like we have taken previously. Empty is basically a variable which will give P the idea about the number of empty slots that are there. Like, for example, here, how many number of empty slots are there? 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. So that's the reason the value of empty here is how much? 5. Okay, so it basically gives me the number of empty slots. Then full, basically, like empty, full is just the reverse. That means how many slots are occupied. So how many slots are occupied? 3 slots. So that's why the value of full is how much? 3. Okay, so basically I have used here a binary semaphore. Okay. All right. So now let me say that initially the value of binary semaphore is equal to what? 1. When the value of binary semaphore is equal to 1, when the resource is available for the processes to be utilized. Okay, once again, I'm saying when the value of binary semaphore is equal to 1, it is equal to 1 when the resource is available by the processes to be utilized. The value of binary semaphore has to be changed to 0 once that resource is given to a process. So that is the meaning. So 0 means here means that resource is not available because that resource is now allocated to some other process. When S is equal to 1, it means that that resource is now is available by a resource, by a process to be taken. Okay, so that is basically the what you can say meaning. Okay, now coming to the point. Now there are two parts of the code. One, the consumer part. This is the consumer. Now these are not together. Okay, this is the consumer part of the code. This line. This is the consumer part of the code, and this is the producer part of the code. Okay, once again, I'm saying this is the consumer part of the code and this is the producer part of the code. Okay. Now let us check. So these are the items which are available in the memory. Okay, so let us see. First of all, suppose if I want to produce any item. So produce item, maybe it may be a function. Okay, so it is passing an argument item P. Now, first of all, if suppose I have to insert any item into the, into the buffer, then how I have to do it? Okay, so we have to do it this way. So if producer process wants to insert any item, then it has to first change the value of n. Okay, so it has to change the value of n from 5 to 4. It has to, okay, if it has to, what is n? Okay, sorry. N is taken as empty only here. Okay. N is taken as empty only here. So, n basically will mean the number of empty slots. So, suppose I have to increase here, let's say D, another item. Okay. So, how many initially, before D, how many items were there? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So, if I will insert one more item, then what will happen? I have to decrement. That means from 5, I have to change to how much? 4. So, one unit, I have to lesser it down. Okay. So, let's see if producer wants to insert an item, then it has to change the value of N. In this case, N I have taken. This N and that N don't mix up. N in this case is basically, you can say, the number of items which are, you can say, empty. Okay. So I will change something because otherwise there will be error. Okay. And then, so using this one, down empty means what? Down empty will basically be a part of the code. Okay. It's a function in the C code, which will change the value of N one unit less. Why one unit less? Because whenever we are inserting any item, N value should be decremented. Why? Because N value is basically giving me the value of the empty cell. So if suppose a new item is inserted, the empty cell will be reduced. One empty cell will be reduced. So that is the reason we are decrementing the value of N. Now, if suppose I am using that buffer, so the semaphore value also has to be changed, because semaphore, if it is 1, it will still be giving the indication to other processes that I can consume or I can insert or whatever I can do with the buffer. So if suppose that happens, then what I have to do, I have to down the value of S. That means I have to change the value of the semaphore from 1 to what? 0. Okay, so that has to be very clear. In first case, this function down empty will basically change the value of, you can say, n, okay, from 5 to 4. Why it is decrementing? The reason I said that n is basically giving me the idea about how many empty cells are there. So if suppose something is inserted into the buffer array, so definitely that empty cell will be reduced, one empty cell. Why? Because in one of the location of the cell, an item has been inserted. So that's why that reduction by one unit is there. Similarly, if suppose I'm using that cell, okay, that means that block of memory is what? It's a resource for me. So if I am using that resource, other processors cannot use that resource that time. But how will I indicate? So for that, I have to change the semaphore value from 1 to 0. So the moment I do this, what message will be passed to the other process? That I have to basically wait, because that buffer is not now available. Okay, so this is basically the entry section of the critical, you can say, of the process. Okay, now this part of the code will basically be the part which will be, why is modern used not modern? Okay, why is modern? Okay, if I suppose use, let's say if I take mod n here, okay, let me come to this point. Okay, so we'll clarify that time. Now look here, buffer in is equal to item p. Okay, so there are mistakes in here, you have to correct it. Buffer in is assigned to item p. So item p means whatever item has been produced that will be allocated into the buffer. Okay, so in we already have seen what is in. Okay, so here in is equal to 3. Why in is equal to 3? Value where we can enter the item and then execute in is equal to in plus 1 mod of n is assigned to 4, thus making it a value equals to 4. All right, very good. So initially, where is in? Where are we? Initially, if suppose we are inserting the item, so in will always be the value where we will be inserting the item, isn't it? All right. So here in this case, buffer in. So which location of the array we will be inserting? 3, right? So buffer 3 is equal to item P. So let's say item is D. Okay. So item is D. So item P value is D. So D will be inserted in buffer in. What is in? In is 3. Why 3? Because the last time that we had inserted was in this part of the memory location, isn't it? This array, okay, buffer 2's one. Now, in is basically one unit more because every time it will be pointing to the next location. So buffer 3 will basically give me this part of the memory which is available. So once it inserts, so think that D has been inserted. So the one is insert, then its value has to be incremented. By how much it will be incremented? It will be incremented by one unit. So in plus one, let me take another variable, let's say n. Okay, now I've taken two variables here. Small n will basically give me total, you can say, size of the array. So here, what was the total size? 8, right? And big N, capital N, will basically give me the value of the empty slots. So that is the difference out here that I have used. Is it clear now? Small N is basically the total size of the array of the buffer, and capital N is basically the number of empty slots which are available. I will update in that note. Is it clear or not, Arbaz?
Yes, sir, it's clear.
Okay. All right. So thus making the value is equal to 4. Okay. So what will this 4 indicate? This new value of in means that next I time any item, if it is inserted, then it has to be in from this location of buffer. Okay. So once this is done, so once this code is executed in the critical section, if suppose any other process comes and wants also, then it will not be able. Why? Because the semaphore value is set to how much? The semaphore value for that buffer array is set to zero. That means that that buffer memory is not available right now, okay, for using. So that's why it's not available. So once you've executed this code, this should be small n. So once you have executed this code, we come to the entry section of the exit section of the code. Okay. So what will it do? Up s. That means now it will up the value of s. So it will change the value of s now from 0 to 1. So what will this indicate? That means, okay, now our, you can say, array is available for using. Okay. Then up full. What is up full? Up full will basically change the value now of full. Full, we already know. What is full? Full, we already know. Full was basically the number of empty, full slots, sorry. Full was basically the number of full slots. So it that all changed. So initially, the number of full slots, 3. So now it is how much? 4. So that also will be updated. Okay, so that is from the producer part. Consumer's part also, it's same. So once the producer has done its part, now let us go to the consumer part. Now, in the consumer part also, what will it do? In the consumer part also, okay. What will it do in the consumer part? In the consumer part, first of all, it will down the value of full. So what was full? Full was basically giving me the idea of which are the slots which are occupied or which are full. So it has to change the value of those, like of the full. Okay, so initially, like for example here, okay, how, what was the value? 4. Full was how much? 4. So here full was how much? 4. So if suppose I'm taking this item A, so full value now has to be changed to what? 3, because if this item is consumed by the consumer process, okay, so how many slots will be full now? Only 3 slots. So that value has to be updated. Now once I have done my part, then what I will do? I will now use this memory for consuming. That means while the consumption of the items is taking place, once the when the items are being taken from the memory, that time no other process should be able to make use of the memory or of the array. Once again, I'm saying once the consumption of items is going on, that time no other process should be able to make use of that memory. So for that, what I need to do? Again, I have to change the semaphore value. Okay, that means to, so as to indicate the other processes that this array is in use. So what I have to do? I have to down the value of S. Down the value of S means I have to change the value of semaphore of that array from 1 to 0. So the moment I do this, what will it happen? This will give an indication to other process that no, you have requested, but we cannot give you. Why? Because the semaphore is set to 0. That means it is, this array is being used by some process. Okay. Then once we do this, what we will do? Now we will take out the item from the buffer. So it's very easy, buffer out. Okay. So buffer out. So out, let's say out was initialized to 0. Okay, because it will be running in this order. So let's say 0. So buffer of 0. So what was their item? A. So buffer of 0 is A. So A will be allocated to C. Okay. So once this is done, so this will be out of the array A. So did I show that one? Okay. This will be out of the array A. It's not array A, sorry. The item A will be out of the array. So this will be no longer be there. Okay. So the moment this has been consumed by the consumer process, so we have to now increase the value of out. So that next time when it tries to access the location from where it can consume, so it will be able to access the next location. So that's why we are incrementing it. Then once this part of the code is executed, because this is the part of the code which will be executed in the critical section, now we have to release, we should be out of the system. So how we do that? And how we make others aware that this memory space is now free. So what we have to do, we have to now up the value of semaphore. So the moment I change the value of semaphore from 0 to 1, this will give an indication to other processes that the buffer memory is now free for utilization. And then also update the empty value. So initially, empty value was how much? Before when A was there, it was 4. But the moment A was out of the memory space, so now empty value has been increased to 5 units. Okay. So this is basically we are doing when there is no preemption. That means we are using semaphore. Okay, but when there is no preemption or context, okay, but the challenge comes whenever there is a context switching, we have seen, isn't it? When one process is executing, it has to stop because a higher priority process comes, the control goes somewhere else, then the race condition develops. So it is that time where the main challenge comes. Okay, so we will see now this part, like how we are going to do it, okay? So till here, is it clear? The next one is not so difficult and short also. Is it clear? You can type. Others, is it clear or not? Okay, very good then. Let us go to the next one. Airbus is typing.
No, sir. That was a mistake. Just continue.
Okay. Fine. Okay. Now, whenever there is a context switching or if there is a preemption, then how do we tackle that race condition problem? Okay. So same logic only here also. Certain errors are there. Please update. Okay. Now, let's say we are having N here is equal to 8, empty is equal to 5, and value is equal to 3. I think it should be full. Okay. Should be full is equal to 3. So this is the thing that we are having. Now, how do we do this? So let us try to see. Let us take producer execute the entry section of the code, that is down empty, down S. So empty value changes from 5 to 4. However, before it could execute down S, code is preempted. At this point, consumer enters the system and executes the entry section of the code. That is down full, down S. It should update the full value of 3 to 2 and semaphore. Then this shall enter and execute. Okay. So the initialing, all right. Now, when the consumer, okay. So let us take producer executes the entry section of the code. That is down empty and down S. So empty value changes from 5 to 4, okay. Okay, let me little bit change the context here. Okay, now let us see in this situation, the producer basically wants to now enter certain item, okay. So what it will do, it will run the code from its side. So this is the producer part of the code, and this is the consumer part of the code. So in the producer part, it has run this code, okay. In the producer side, let us see, it has run this code. So let me highlight this one. Okay, it has run this code. Okay, now before it could go to the next line of code, that means before it could, change the value of semaphore, there was a context switch. That means consumer process came. Why it came? There can be various reasons. As we said, interrupt took place, higher priority process came, or maybe the time quantum that was allocated to one process, it expired. It may be various reasons. So there is a, you can say, context switch here, okay? Or preemption, I should write, no better. Preemption took place, okay? And then consumer process has come, okay? So the control now goes to the consumer process, okay? So what it could execute, it could change, update the value of empty only. So empty was how much? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So empty it make now, it made 4. Okay, but semaphore it could not change. That means semaphore was still, you can say, same only, 1 only. So now another process came. So control will come to consumer. So consumer, it will execute this code. Okay, consumer will execute this code. Wait 1 second, it's creating issue. Where is this one? Okay, all right. So let me say that it executed this code, that means full value it changed. So full you can say before 4, but it changed to 3. Okay, then it will make use of the semaphore now. So what will it do? It will change the value of semaphore from 1 to 0, because semaphore value could not be changed here in the producer part. Before it could come here, the control went here, and then it is executing this part of the code. So it changed the value of semaphore from 1 to 0. So the moment it does so, what will happen? The moment it does so, then in that case, you can say it will be changing the value of semaphore from 1 to 0. So that 0 will basically give an indication to the other process that the buffer memory is not available. Why? Because we can know that the moment semaphore value is 0, that resource is we cannot use, because it is being used by some process. Okay, so it will enter into the critical section. So after it enters the critical section, then it will, as usual, do its work. So item C is assigned to buffer out. Okay, so whatever is the value of out, so initially will be what? 0. So buffer 0 is assigned to C. So what will happen? Item C. So that means A, buffer out means buffer 0. It's A. So A is assigned to C. So after it has assigned to C, that will be taken out from the, you can say from the memory. And then we will increment the value of out. Why we are incrementing the value of out? We already said that. So that it will be pointing to the next location. And next time, when we want to take any content from the memory, then we will be able to do it very easily, because we know the location. Okay. So once this is done, this is the part of the code which will be very crucial, and it will be executing in the critical section. So once this is done, then we will release the resources which has been, you can say, taken by the consumer process. So how will it release? It has to notify others also that it has used this resource. So how will it notify? First, it will change the value of semaphore from zero to 1. So the moment the semaphore value is changed, this up S, that means up the semaphore is changed, that means it will send indication to others that the now the resource is available. So accordingly, it can change the empty, you can say variable also. Okay, so this variable, we already said that it is giving us the idea about the empty slot. So it will update that value. Now it'll exit. Okay, now once this is done, the CPU will check, is any other process available or not? Is any process available or not? So it will come here. So it'll come here. Once it comes here, it will not start from the beginning. It will start from the point where it has finished, because we already know that all the information will be saved in the process control block. So from wherever the point it had suspended, from that point onwards only the execution will start. So again, it will change the value of semaphore of this array, because it wants to use the array. So it will store the item in the buffer memory. Okay, and once it stores, it will increment the in value so that it can point to the next location where the value will be stored. Okay, now this is a case where basically the context switching is being done very, very nicely. Whereas in that case, whenever we did context switching without a semaphore, it had no idea basically, like from where it has to start. Okay, even if it is start from this point, then will there be a data mismanagement or conflicting of values of data? That was there. Okay, similarly, let's say, for example, if we have a situation like this, the semaphore, another situation. Okay, let me release this one. I'll take another situation. Now let us take a situation. Let's say producer has come into the picture. Producer has come into the picture. The process, it has executed this code down empty. Okay, it has executed. Using the semaphore, using the array. So it has changed the semaphore value from 0 to 1. Now in this stage, once it has entered the critical section, that time a higher priority process comes. Okay, again, I am saying, once the producer has changed the value of semaphore and it has entered into the critical section, that means CPU has been given to the producer, okay, for execution. Now, at that instant of time, consumer has come and consumer has a higher priority process. So what will happen? Will there be a context switch? Yes, the CPU has to be given to the consumer. Why? Because it is a higher priority process. But when the consumer will be executing its code, it will be pointless. It will be blocked. Why? Because let's say at this point, at this instant, let me say, context switching took place, the preemption took place, but semaphore is already changed. At this point, semaphore is already changed from one to zero. So what will this mean? That means the memory space is already given to the producer. So even if there is a context switch at this point, even if the control is given to the consumer because it is a higher priority process, it will execute this code. It will update the value of full. But the moment when it will come here, consumer process will be at a halt. Why? Because semaphore is zero. So the moment he will see that semaphore is zero, that means I cannot utilize this code, isn't it? I'll not be able to do anything. So again, the control will go back. So in this situation, we see that even if there is a context switch or preemption at any point of time, okay, but once the semaphore value is changed, it's reset to zero, then even if there is a preemption, okay, the control will come back to the process which is supposed to execute. That means the process which has changed the value of semaphore. So in this way, there will be no data mismanagement. Because until and unless the process has not completed its execution and it has not changed the value of semaphore, okay, till that time other processes have to wait. So once it has executed its critical section part and it has upped the value of semaphore, then only it can be given the control. Okay, so this is how basically we are handling the problem of context switching, or you can say preemption, in case of producer consumer. Is it clear? Was it difficult? Okay, very good. So I will give you the updated notes, because certain updations I took, I because while typing the notes, I made very fast, okay? So certain things like typing the language was not proper, but while doing live only, I encountered that these issues are there, so I updated live, okay? So let me save this and I will... This is not required. One more mistake yesterday I did. I saw, let us consider the semaphore associated with each, a process, okay? That process fork, you can see. This also. Yesterday, the video I saw, so that is updated now. I'm sending you. You can upload in the official website, the WhatsApp group. Okay, so one more thing. Tomorrow I will not take class because sir wants to take system software. So tomorrow I think sir will be taking from 3, told me. So accordingly, you can connect with sir, because one day I think it's difficult for you to manage the data pack, isn't it? So that way, it's better that one day I think one faculty takes. Otherwise, managing the data pack, I think for you all will be very tough. So in that way, I think you all can do search class, and then maybe Sunday I'll take, or maybe Monday, let me check accordingly. So I think I've done almost process synchronization, everything. Monitors, I've given you the notes, so you just read, all of you. If you need assistance, then I will help you. If not, then we can look for other topics. I think I will like to do process scheduling, algorithms, and numericals, no? Because those are very important. So those I will want to do it. And any suggestions from you all? Anything? Okay, then, so that completes our session.